Welcome to another GCN Tech Clinic. Coming up this week, I answer your questions on Groupset compatibility, carbon bike maintenance, and some more upgrade questions. Don't forget, if you do have a question too, drop it in the box below or throw it onto the social media platforms using the hashtag AskGCNTech for any of your bike-related queries. The first question on today's show is from Jack Caples, who writes in with, "Hi guys, I have an older 10-speed Centaur groupset. I saw there is a newer 10-speed version available with the Ergo Power lever shifters. Is it possible to just upgrade the shifters? Would there be any compatibility issues with the rest of the groupset?" Well, Jack, that is a very good question. And in fact, it's quite a popular question here on the channel. And the short answer is yes, it is possible because the rear mech basically does what the front shifter tells it to do. So assuming you're using a 10-speed cassette and a 10-speed shifter, the shifter will give the rear mech the correct amount of indexing between the gears and it will work absolutely flawlessly. It doesn't always work when you cross manufacturers, so you wouldn't want to use Campag and Sharam necessarily. It might work, it might not always because of the ratios that you use on cable pull, but in your case, Centaur and Campag, they will work absolutely fine, and in fact, is a really good upgrade for your bike, so enjoy. Next up is a question from Felix. "Hi, I just bought a used carbon bike. Are there any maintenance tips regarding carbon bikes specifically? Cheers." Well, Felix, the one thing to remember with carbon is that it is in fact incredibly strong. The only thing I would say though is to be aware of putting any stress on the tubes in directions or planes that they were not designed to withstand. So what I mean by this is years ago, it's quite popular for people to walk up to a carbon bike and squeeze the tubes, and they would squeeze them quite hard to see how much they deflected to test the stiffness of the bike. This is in fact a big no-no, as you can delaminate the carbon on the inside and weaken the tube structurally, which wouldn't be good at all, would it? It also wasn't relevant to testing the bike because it wasn't designed to be strong in that direction, was it? Other than that, what you want to do is just look after your bike in any way you would normally. Use carbon gripper paste in areas like the seat post to prevent that from slipping. And if you don't already own one, your next purchase should be a torque wrench, as this is it's more important with carbon because you can crack a tube and not necessarily see it. Whereas at least with aluminium, you can see it bending if you were to over tighten something. Good luck and enjoy your new purchase. Jim Tilbrook is up next with a question about bottom brackets. "I've got a 1990 Reynolds 531 Holdsworth frameset and I want to upgrade the groupset to the new Shimano R7000 105. I plan to do some bucket list climbs this year, an 1134 cassette and bar shifters. Will a Durace R9000 bottom bracket holotech design fit, as it's only £20? With it so many different specs of bottom brackets, it's confusing." And you're right, it is confusing. There are loads out there. But luckily for you, Jim, the R9000 bottom bracket will fit the R7000 cranks, as the measurements and the spindle widths are exactly the same. Shimano are basically, on the whole, all compatible with each other. All you need to do is check the thread housing on your frame. Is it a 68mm English thread? Well, in that case, all you need to do is clean out the bottom bracket threads, apply a little bit of anti-seize paste or grease, as either will prevent the bottom bracket from seizing in there, screw in the bottom bracket, and then fit your new cranks, and it should work like an absolute dream. I hope you enjoy riding your bucket list climbs, and it sounds like you're gonna have a lot of fun on that bike. Gazy85 is having trouble with water collecting inside of his rims. "After washing my bike, my deep section wheels always retain some of the water, as I can hear it swishing around even a few weeks after a wash. I use a hose, but with very little pressure, just enough to rinse the dirt from the bike and put the valves at the top to avoid the water running down inside there. How can I avoid this and still get my wheels nice and clean?" Well, Gazy, that is quite a normal problem, in fact. And depending on the rims you have, you may even have your own solution, as many manufacturers actually include two tiny little holes either opposite the rim, or by the valve to allow the water to trickle out. If you have these, then your problem solved, basically. It's really easy. All you have to do is put these at the bottom of near the ground, so the gravity can help you and the water will drain right out. Overnight should be long enough to allow it to trickle out, apart from a drop or two. If you don't have these though, and you're still having a problem, then I recommend whipping your wheels out of the bike before you rinse the bike. Clean your wheels with just a damp cloth, as this will almost certainly clean them thoroughly enough. If you're still having water in there though, then you may want to remove your tire and any rim tape that you have inside of the rim, and then allow the water to trickle out through the valve hole or the nipple holes. Good luck, and hopefully that has helped. Gary Allen writes in next on Twitter. I think I found this one. "Hey John, great show, loving the content. I've recently purchased a pair of GP5000 Continental tyres, tubular version, and I pumped them up to 100 PSI. Is this too high, as I sometimes find the rear wheel drifts as I'm cornering? Many thanks." Well, Gary, that's a really good question, but we need a little bit more information to answer that clearly. First off, how heavy are you? Do you weigh 100 kilos? Well, if you weigh 100 kilos, then 100 PSI probably isn't far off. But because you say that you feel like the rear wheel is drifting, I'm going to assume you're not. The next question to ask, though, is what width tyre are you running? The narrower the tyre, the harder you need to blow them up. But if you're running a 25, which is generally the norm these days, I would recommend the following formula. It's really easy. 1 psi per kilo of body weight for any tyre between 25 to 28 millimetres. Obviously, that's not an exact estimate, and based on rider preference, you may want to go up or down. So what I would recommend is to start out at your 100 psi and let 5 psi out until you get to a pressure where you're really comfortable with. I would also always put a tiny bit more in the back, or conversely, put a little bit less in the front. Good luck and enjoy your new tyres. Another question over on Twitter from Cole de Polesworth. I've got a 2013 Scott CR1 Pro that I absolutely love, but I'd really like to have a bike with Di2. Instead of buying a new bike, could I convert my Scott? Thanks for your advice. From Steve. Well, yes, you absolutely can, Steve. And in fact, it won't be that difficult to do. The major issue you're going to be faced with is sealing over those frame holes that you're going to have where the tiny wires go in where the big cables used to. But there are bungs available on the internet, and if you can't find them, I'm sure you can fashion something yourself. Once you've done that, you're going to have a really neat looking build, as wires look so much better than cables, and I think you'll breathe a whole new lease of life into your Scott, and I'm sure you'll really enjoy the ride. Mechanical shifting is great, but I really do like Di2, and I'm sure you will as well. Enjoy. Craig Evans is planning some upgrades. I'm swapping out my old 105 rear derailleur for the Ultegra R8000 derailleur with an Ultegra R6800 chain. How do I check the correct chain length? Surely I can't just measure my old chain, can I? Well, Craig, let's start by assuming that your old chain was in fact the correct length, in which case you can. You can lie them side by side and make sure that the corresponding links line up, or simply count them out. The reason for this, you want to make sure that the same amount of links, is because an old chain will stretch ever so slightly, but it's unlikely to be so far that you lose track of where that link is on the other chain, on the new chain. And then you want to make sure that your rear met cages are of a similar length. The fashion these days is to go for longer rear met cages because we now ride with wider range group sets, cassettes on the back. So in the past, it would have been like a 25, 12 perhaps, whereas these days it's not uncommon to see a 34, 11. So a long cage rear met is much more popular to see on bikes, in which case you would want to add an extra link or two onto your chain. So the way to test it is to shift into the big ring, your 50 or your 52 or whatever it is on the front, and the 30 or 32 on the back. And then thread the chain through the rear mech, pull it tight, and then make sure you can actually access that gear. Even if you never intend to ride in that gear, you need to be able to access it for accidental shifting, because if you try and shift into that gear and your chain isn't long enough, you're likely to rip the rear mech from the bike, and frankly, that would be a bit of a disaster. Enjoy your new upgrades, and I'm sure you'll have no problems. The final question this week comes from Twitter, and Ross Mendenhall writes in with, I've bought a new Canyon Aeroad with Ultegra 8070 Di2. It has shorter cranks than my old bike, which has a stages power meter on mechanical 6800. Can I swap this with the chain rings to keep it working with the Di2 rather than not have to buy another power meter? Well, it's a really good question, and I can understand not wanting to buy another power meter. And when you say swap chain rings, do you actually mean to swap the cranks over to continue using your power meter on the new bike? In which case, you should have absolutely no problem. A Shimano crankset is compatible with all Shimano group sets, such is the design, which makes it a really, really easy swap. You may need to adjust your front derailleur if for whatever reason you have different sized rings on both bikes. Enjoy your new bike, and once you've got the power meter on there, I'm sure you'll enjoy the data that you get from it as well. That is it for this week's show. Don't forget though, if you do have any questions that you would like to be answered on the Tech Clinic, use the hashtag AskGCNTech across any of the social media platforms. We will find your question. But if you want to make it really easy for us, you can just drop them down in the comments box here. I'm sure it won't be long before John, or in fact Ollie, make an appearance back in the Tech Clinic themselves. If you haven't already done so, check out the latest episode in John's Cheap Bike to Superbike. It's getting pretty exciting now.